Welcome to Community Conversations. We have a pretty exciting conversation coming up today with a Bexley alum who has done great, great things in the world. We're with Natalia Fednor. She is a 2001, is that right, graduate of Bexley High School?
That's right, yes.
2001 graduate. She was born in Ukraine. So she, as a small child, lived in Ukraine. Her family moved to Columbus and she spent her youth in Columbus and went through the Bexley school system. She went on to Parsons School of Design in New York City. She became a contestant on Project Runway, where she was, she got herself out there. She worked for some of the major designers in the world. And now she designs independently in New York and Los Angeles for some of the biggest name celebrities in the world. So she's doing amazing things. And we're excited to hear about her journey and also to find out about how someone can take something that they love and turn it into an amazing career and life. So Natalia, welcome.
Hi. Hello, everybody.
So happy to have you.
Yes, it's great to have you as well. Just before we get started, should I spotlight the video? I'm still kind of new to Zoom. Don't hate me.
I don't know.
Better, or how do we want to do it?
I don't know if it matters. I don't know. I don't know the difference, to tell you the truth.
What do you, when I just hit, guys, you see mostly me, right?
Yes.
And then if I undo that.
If you screen share it, then we'll see what's on your screen.
Okay. Does this work for everyone? Is this okay?
That's great.
All right, I can so still
Natalia, tell us about your journey. Tell us about how you, you went from being this little kid to this accomplished designer that you are today.
Sure, I would love to. I for those of you who just joined, I do want to point out, as Steve said earlier, that Miss Young, my elementary school at Maryland Avenue Elementary School art teacher, is here, and this means so much to me. She's actually one of my inspirations, and she took so much time with me independently, individually as an elementary school kid. And that now that I'm an adult, looking back on it, realizing how busy teachers are, that they do have personal lives, it means even more. So it really is very special to have her here, and hopefully I'll make her proud. So a little bit about me. I was born in Chernivtsi, Ukraine, and I immigrated to Columbus, Ohio when I was 6 years old. So English is not my first language. I know a lot of the people on this talk today are middle school students. If you can do me a favor, actually, if you see the chat box, please in the chat box, let me know what grade you're in. If you're in middle school or high school, I know that the structure has changed since I was in school. And if you could also let me know what you want to be when you grow up or when you graduate, depending on what point you are in your life. I'm actually going to open up the chat so I can see you guys. All right, awesome. Okay, back to my little story. So I spoke Russian when I moved here. I was actually born in Ukraine, but it was the Soviet Union back then, which means it was sort of owned by Russia and everybody spoke Russian. So I actually don't speak Ukrainian. I only speak Russian. And I ended up at Bexley in third grade and at Maryland Avenue Elementary. And it was the first time I went to a public school. And it was definitely scary, and there was a lot of culture shock, and very overwhelming. But one thing that was true for me as a young person is that teachers were incredibly encouraging of my art talent, including Miss Young. So I don't know how you guys deal with things right now, but for me, as a child, as a teenager, art was a really great way for me to cope with stress, to cope with anxiety. I mean, I remember getting sent to the principal's office in high school because I kept doodling during class. And now that I'm an adult looking back on it, I realized that doodling was the way that I was able to better listen. So if I didn't keep my hands busy, my eyes busy, I actually had a really hard time listening to the teacher. So doodling was my coping mechanism. Now, back then I was getting punished for it. Hopefully nowadays they don't send kids to the principal's office for doodling in the side margins of their homework. So I do remember those days really well. And so I did a lot of art as a child. I went to Columbus College of Art and Design on Saturdays for art classes, which was very inspirational as well. I'm really happy that that program existed. And I was a scholarship student there, which was also really helpful because my family did not have much money as a child. And I got to learn a lot in those classes. It really made me a sharper artist. I think I had a certain level of natural talent that I can't take any credit for, but taking those art classes and having really encouraging teachers was certainly helpful. So for the teachers and the staff members who are on this call, know that you do make a world of difference. I mean, a world of difference. It really is hugely impactful to a young person to be told that what they've done is exceptional or interesting and to be encouraged to continue to learn and pursue it. And when I was in elementary school, I remember with Miss Young, she had us dry out boards and she was really into Fimo jewelry. And I thought that was the coolest thing ever. And I remember we had a couple of days where I was like, Miss Young, can you please teach me how to do this? And she took the time during her own lunch times to teach me. And I was just this little student that she had just met. And looking back on it, that means so much. So as teachers and as students, feel free to reach out to your teachers. And as teachers, I encourage you to participate in your students' lives, because even now at my ripe old age of 37, I still remember that. And I don't remember much anymore, but I remember that. So that was elementary school. And in high school, but around sixth grade, I started to learn about something called fashion design. I didn't know what fashion design was as a kid. I liked to draw Barbies, and I sort of noticed that the Barbie always kind of looked the same that I was drawing, but she was always wearing a different outfit. And eventually I realized, hey, there's a word for this. It's called fashion design. And that's when I started to look into fashion design more. And by the time I got to high school, I was able to start subscribing to certain magazines back then. It was like W Magazine. Now everything's online. But back then we still had really beautiful big print magazines. And I was really into it. I really loved very artistic fashion. And so by the time I was a junior in high school, I knew that that's what I wanted to pursue. And I started researching colleges and applied. I'm going to take a quick look at the chat box just to get an understanding of, you know, the ages of people in this chat today. All right.
While you're looking at that, Natalia, I think one of the things that's really cool is, you know, for as a kid, like the thing that you were punished for, the thing that was problematic was just the thing you did naturally. And I think it's really interesting for all of us to pay attention. What are the clues, the things that we, you know, if you look at your own life and look for clues, what are the things that I loved doing? What are the things that I did naturally or that I always wanted to do, even on my free time? And that gives you a little hint about what, you know, what your natural kind of curiosity.
That's very true. That's very true. I see a lot of you guys are in middle school, and I see one person who's in the 11th grade, which is great. And I know some of you here are letting me know that you want to be fashion designers, which is wonderful. Yeah, it's you do have to pay attention to that. And I do think as students pay attention, but also as teachers and as parents pay attention to that, because now things are really, I think things are much better now than when I was a child, and probably even way better than when some of my teachers were children, because I think certain artistic and athletic tendencies are more encouraged. Whereas, you know, maybe when I was growing up, sometimes you would hear the whole thing about don't be a starving artist, you know, which is really sort of a naive expression, because the truth is, as a designer, it is much easier for me to get a job than most people who are only trained in one thing. I could do graphic design, I could do website design, I could do illustrations, I can do fashion design, I can make my own clothing, I can sew a mask. So it's a false sort of, what do you call it? It's a false statement. You don't have to be a starving artist. It all depends on how you apply your art. You could be a teacher, you know? So that's I think the big thing. Yeah, pay attention to your own talents, but also maybe don't pay so much attention to when people tell you what you should or shouldn't be doing. You know, if you love something enough and you're passionate enough and you're willing to work really, really, really hard at it, you can find a way to make it happen. Because I know some of us, our parents might say, you know what, we'll pay for college, but only if you go and get this very traditional law degree or this very traditional medical degree. And that might be very heartbreaking for some of you to know that your parents have certain expectations of you. And I'm not trying to discourage you from following your parents' dreams, but I do think you should consider your own dreams and have a really honest conversation with your parents and realize that if your parents don't support those dreams or people in your community don't support those dreams, you're gonna have to work really hard. You're gonna have to save a lot of money. You're gonna have to have multiple jobs while you're in school and college to pay for those dreams, because that's what happens when you pursue your own path. Like, and guess what? All of that is gonna make you an even better artist or an even better whatever, because a little bit of adversity makes you more interesting and it makes you more hardworking and more passionate. And I think as a culture, we really respond to people who are passionate about what they do. So that's a very long spiel on that.
Yeah. You made your college choice based on your interest. You chose Parsons School of Design. You wanted to go to New York. You wanted to kind of get yourself into that world.
Yes. Yeah, I definitely did. And I come from a traditional Russian Jewish family where I should have been a doctor or a lawyer. And that was certainly impressed upon me many, 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 many times. And I had very, very good grades in high school. I was very academic. I was valedictorian the year I graduated, one of a couple of valedictorians, and I had a very excellent GPA, and I did not apply to a single Ivy League. And I know that I had students in my class who were like, you could go to Harvard. What are you doing? And I'm like, I just spent 4 years working my butt off on academics, and I have no desire to keep doing that. Like, I am happy I did it. It made me the eloquent speaker that I currently am because I had those amazing Bexley High School English classes, but it also wasn't what I was passionate about. And I knew that at an early age, maybe earlier than some of my peers, that it was really important for me to pursue the thing that I loved because I was willing to work much harder at the thing I loved than something that was maybe more traditional or maybe more financially lucrative. And it took my parents a while to come around, but they did. They're very, very supportive now. I used to joke that with my father, the tipping point was when I dressed Jennifer Lopez. Apparently, Jennifer Lopez is the common denominator. So she's, if you can dress J-Lo, everything will be accepted in your life. But back to, I guess, Steve, I don't know if you had any more questions on the tangent. I can kind of continue on to the biography.
No, take us to your professional life.
Okay, great. So I got to Parsons when I was 18 years old and I moved to New York City, which was so exciting for me because one of the first places I ever saw as a child was New York City. When we immigrated from Ukraine, we actually immigrated through New York. So even though we moved to Columbus, we were in New York for about 2 weeks where my mom's friend told her there were no jobs and we should really look elsewhere, which is how we ended up in Ohio. And one of my first impressions was Times Square, was New York, the good, the bad. I remember seeing homeless people for the first time and being really sort of overwhelmed by the idea that there are people in this world who don't have parents to take care of them. You have to remember I was about 5 or 6. And just also the lights and everything, it was just so exciting. And so for a very long time, I knew that I wanted to study in New York almost before I even knew what I wanted to study. So I went to Parsons, New York, and then eventually I went to Parsons, Paris, in Paris, which is also something I always wanted to do. It's why I took French classes in high school, so that I could eventually go to Paris, the capital of fashion. So I highly encourage you guys, if you have something that you're pursuing and has a specific culture associated with it, do what you can to learn more about that culture, whether it's taking a language class or taking a history class or whatever it is that immerses you in it. And I believe in high school, I did a trip to Paris, actually. There was sort of like a spring. I don't know if you guys still do this, but in the spring you could go to, I think, either Spain or France with the language class you were in. And I did the French trip. So that was really exciting. And it was back when France still had francs. Yeah. And then I remember that switched over so that by the time I went to Paris when I was 21, it was euros. So that was really that cusp of time period between francs and euros when the European Union became a thing. So that's kind of exciting to think about. And that's thanks to Bexley that I had that wonderful experience. I actually think that part of my trip was paid for by some sort of a scholarship that I got through Bexley. So there's just, I have a lot of gratitude for the amazing opportunities that Bexley gave me. While I was at Parsons, a lot of amazing and a lot of scary things happened. Steve, I saw you move your arm.
I was gonna get you I wanted to get to some pictures eventually.
Yes, I'm sorry. I'm realizing, and I know a lot of you guys are in 6th and 7th grade and you're like, oh, this lady is so boring. I'm just kidding. I'll get you guys some pictures, I promise. So I know for a lot of you guys who are in 6th, 7th grade, that means you're 12, 13 years old. You weren't born when September 11th happened, but I was 18 when it happened. And I didn't know what the Twin Towers were. You, as a 6th grader, know more about the Twin Towers than I did as a 6th grader. I had no idea what the Twin Towers were. And I'm in New York City, I'm 18 years old, I finally have freedom from my parents. I mean, like, this has been something I've wanted forever. And I finally am my own in New York City. And then September 11th happens and everything dramatically changes. And I was in the part of New York City that was locked down because we were close enough to the tower. And what I learned in that process was that a city that is considered loud and rude and overwhelming can really come together to be kind and gentle and understanding and very helpful. And I think as a designer and a creative person, this was incredibly informative to me. And the reason why I bring this up in today's talk, even though I know I'm talking to you guys that are not necessarily in college at this moment, is because as artistic human beings, as any sort of person who wants to pursue something like this, you have to pay attention to your environment and what's happening around you, and you can't ignore it and you can't live in a bubble. And we're currently in a very stressful situation with coronavirus. And I encourage you to explore your creativity during this time period. It's scary. It's scary for everyone. It's scary for your mom and dad. It's scary for their bosses. It's scary for me. So it's okay to draw about it. It's okay to write about it, to journal about it, to be honest with your feelings. And don't feel like you have to hold it inside or have to do any one thing right or wrong. I'm sure the switch over to Zoom classes has been a little bit confusing for some of you, and that's okay to write about that. So I'm just going to encourage that. And now I'm going to show you some highlights from the celebrity world, because I know you guys are excited about some images. I will say that I took a few years off between school and starting my line. So I didn't start my line until I was about 30 years old. And I'm going to start screen sharing now. So the thing with, oh, I guess I have to desktop. The thing with starting one's line, and I always say is it's not so much about how much money you have, even though that is important. Can you guys see my screen right now?
Yes. Yep.
Awesome. The thing with that is that it's more about confidence. And I didn't have the confidence to start my own line until I was 30. That's how long it took for me to feel that I deserved that.
So Natalia, did you come out of college and work for some other designers first to like get some experience and kind of learn the field?
Yes, yes. And this video I'm playing right now has no sound, so I'm going to continue to talk while it plays. This is sort of a celebrity highlight video. This is Beyonce right now, and then I'm going to. So when I was in college, I had a million internships. I think I had like 8 or 9 internships between my 2 degrees. And as students, I believe you guys can do shadowing projects, and you might even be able to score an internship in high school. And I so fully encourage you to do this. I learned so much from my internships, not just what I wanted to do, but what I didn't want to do. Because fashion design is a huge category. And I think when we're in high school, we don't really, in middle school too, we don't really realize, we just see maybe Project Runway, we see the glamorous version of it, but you can be a designer of underwear, you can be a designer of sweaters, you can design really beautiful, incredible gowns, or you can design really boring gowns that are a copy of another copy. So I learned that in my internships, and I learned that in college. And some of the designers I interned or worked for were Marc Jacobs, Donna Karan, Calvin Klein, and Calvin Klein actually turned into a job. And this is Jennifer Lopez. Sorry, kids, it's a little sexy. I really loved working at Calvin Klein Collection, but it paid very little, and New York City is very expensive. So I actually switched over to Calvin Klein Jeans, which paid a lot more, but was really boring. So I actually took a few years, and I went to acting school. And I became an actor for a little while. And I want to tell you this because I think when we're in high school and middle school, we often think that we have to pick one thing and just stick for it forever. And the truth is, almost no one I know just picked one thing and stuck to it forever. Life is going to throw all sorts of curveballs at you. Things are certainly not going to be what you expect. And it's completely okay to listen to yourself and go, you know what, I'm going to try something else. When I was in high school, I was in a lot of Bexley High School productions. Musicals and plays. In fact, I remember being in eighth grade and being in the eighth grade musical, being one of the leads in it. So I don't know if you guys still do that. I hope you do. It was a whole lot of fun. And I went and explored that part of my personality, and I don't regret it at all. It was so fun. I don't really act anymore, but giving myself that opportunity as an adult and saying, you know what, I'm going to try. And that way I know that I can sleep at night knowing I tried exactly what I wanted to. So I did act, and I actually acted in TV shows and commercials and a couple of films. And the money I made acting is the money I used to start my line. A lot of people don't know that. So although it wasn't necessarily a super popular career in the sense that you might not have seen me on TV, it was a career that made me money and a career that taught me a lot about people. The video you guys are seeing, you're seeing some Jennifer Lopez, you're seeing some Jessie Millay. That's what's on the screen right now. I've had a lot of luck as a designer to work with incredible performers. So this is GRL, it's a band. The dress on the far right, which is the Angora dress, is the one that I designed. So these are just some of the videos that amazingly talented human beings have worn my pieces in. As a designer, when I started my line, which is the part I'm sure you guys want to hear more about, this is Vic Mensa and Kanye West, by the way. When I started my line, I didn't really know what I was doing because at that point I had taken several years off from the regular fashion industry, which again is to say it's totally okay not to know what you're doing. And the cool thing about starting my line when I'm 30 is I had already failed a bunch of times. And I want to use that word for you guys today, failure. It's totally okay to fail. Failing is how you learn. Failing is how I gained confidence, because instead of seeing failure as defeat, I saw it as, okay, I tried that. That didn't work. What else can I try? On the screen, you have a really important moment for me. This is Lenny Kravitz, and he's wearing my metal top, and it's the Super Bowl, which is a really big deal on so many levels, and I was really proud of this moment, and I was actually so anxious about it because I wasn't sure if he was going to end up wearing the top, because you don't know until it really happens, that I refused to watch the Super Bowl that year. I was literally in my car when my phone started, is that your top? Is that your top? You know, like people recognized it. But I was so scared because it meant so much, and I had just started my line. This was like 5 years ago, I think. And on the screen now is Sports Illustrated, which is a very iconic magazine. And this is Kiki Palmer, who you guys might have seen on Screen Queens, amongst a bunch of other projects and Hustlers. That's her in my outfit on the American Music Awards. All these moments that you're seeing on screen, they didn't happen just because I'm a good designer or a talented artist. They happened because I believe in relationships and I believe in being kind. whenever I meet anyone, whether they're a tailor or a photographer or a makeup artist, I get to know them, I introduce myself, and I try to be nice to them. I try to treat them the way I want to be treated. And I try not to write anyone off because they're not famous enough or not successful enough. There are plenty of stylists I work with that are only 21 years old, which I know is probably sounds old to you guys, but for me at 37, that sounds really young. And so I give them a chance because I know that maybe tomorrow they'll be even more successful than I am. And that's a big part of being an artist, is realizing that everyone has a different growth curve and everyone has a different time period to grow. This is another Kiki Palmer music video. And that's I think that's the secret recipe for my success, is not giving up and being really nice to the people you work with. I do have an anecdote about a tailor, Ludmila Tomaszewska, who I met in Los Angeles, and I really, really credit her for jumpstarting my career. And this is also to say that you never know who you'll meet, you never know what skills you'll get called upon to use. And this is, before I jump into that story, this is Naomi Grossman of American Horror Story. We have a great anecdote. I was Naomi Grossman's website designer before I started my line. For a couple of years while I was an actor, I had to pay my bills and I knew how to website design. And Naomi and I met because I did her website. And when I started my line, that's what happened. I'm actually gonna pause this because I do wanna play this film for you. Actually, you know what? No, we can let it play. This is a fashion film for my line. You guys can watch it. It shows the textile. So Ludmila Tomaszewska was a tailor in Los Angeles. When I started my line, I needed someone to help sew some of the pieces. And I got a referral from a random ribbon shop. Random shop where you buy fabric and ribbons. And the guy said, you know, my customers like this woman, check her out. And we got to know each other in the process of making my line. And she actually said, you know, Natalia, I really need a website. If you build me my website, I'll sew the stuff for free. And I was like, amazing, I don't have a lot of money. I can build your website and you'll sew my first collection for free. So what you're learning from this experience is that you can still barter your skills. You don't have to pay for everything. In the art world, it's totally normal to collaborate. And that collaboration benefited us both. She got a great website out of it and I got a great first collection. When the first collection was complete, I was like, okay, I don't know anyone in LA. I know people in New York, because at this point I'm living in Los Angeles. And all my contacts in New York are kind of old because fashion moves very quickly. So I was like, my dream as a designer is to have my clothing as celebrities. My dream as a designer is to put my clothing on famous people, on red carpets, on the people who are the most daring and willing to wear avant-garde clothing, because that's what I like to design. And I said, Ludmila, I don't know anyone. Can you help me? You've been a tailor in Hollywood for 25 years. I see you work with stylists who work with celebrities. And the video on the screen right now, guys, is a promotional video that we just shot actually in the end of February, right before everything got really crazy. So these are just models in Ukraine, actually. And Ludmila told me that, you know what? I like you. Sit down at my computer, type up the email, attach the images of your designs, and I will type in the toolbox. So she will put in the address of the stylist. That day, she sent my collection to Kim Kardashian. She sent my collection to Jennifer Lopez. And those stylists don't just style one celebrity. Jennifer Lopez's stylist happened to style Shakira and Charlize Theron and a number of other people. I'm going to keep playing another video as I talk. So that was that video. And so we're going to pull up the celebrity edit, which I think you guys are interested in. So if I hadn't formed that relationship with Ludmila, if I hadn't been nice to her and respectful of her, because you got to understand, when you're dealing with a tailor, some people can be really rude to a tailor or seamstress. They see them as below them or whatever. No one is below you. No one is below you. Let's get that straight. And by treating her with respect that she deserved, she treated me with respect and gave me a real heads up. Some of these pictures are me, enjoy. That's me in my element. and I really believe that her belief in me paired with my hard work and my unique designs helped speed up the rate at which I had success. I'm not saying I wouldn't have maybe had success without her, but I don't think it would have come nearly as fast. So that's very vital. Steve, what other questions do students have while we're looking through these videos?
Well, let me turn it to them. I know a lot of you had questions when you signed up for this, and probably a lot of you are having questions as you hear this. If you want to ask a question, Natalia, if you want to unmute yourself and ask, that's great.
Yes, please.
Or if you feel uncomfortable unmuting yourself, you are also welcome to type questions in the chat bar. Does anybody want to jump with a question right now?
Some of you guys wrote a bunch of questions down. If you wrote one of those questions down, please ask it out loud.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I'm trying to see you. Let's see. Go ahead.
Uh-huh. When did you start designing your fashion?
Well, I've been designing since I was a little kid. Like I said, when I was even in elementary school, I was just drawing and I was designing without realizing I was designing. You know, making clothing for my Barbies, making clothing for my troll dolls. So it's totally, designing is something you can do without really realizing there's a word for it. I'm going to pull up some more videos.
So Natalia, when you were drawing pictures of Barbies and putting different clothes on them, when did that turn into you actually making the clothes? I mean,
Okay. So when I was a senior in high school, I really wanted to make my own prom dress and I absolutely did not know how to sew yet. Maybe I'll stop screen sharing for now and we can go back to it in a second.
That's good.
Stop share. All right. And we'll go back. I have some more images and videos I want to show you guys, but they have sound. So I made my own prom dress my senior year of high school and I was terrible at it. I had no idea what I was doing. I did not have any sewing classes under my belt. I was truly a fine artist. I was a really good artist. I was a really good painter. I was a really good drawer, but I could not sew. And my aunt helped me. And actually it's a funny anecdote because I remember when I was in Paris earlier in that year or the year before, I bought fabric and I thought I'm going to get satin fabric for my prom dress. That's the fanciest fabric. But I knew nothing about textiles. So when I went and I spoke a little French and I asked the shopkeepers for some satin, in my head, I thought I was asking for silk, but satin is actually a weave. It's not a fiber. Silk is a fiber. Satin is a weave. And I knew it was going to be expensive. So when they started quoting me these really cheap prices, I was like, amazing. I'm so lucky. I found the cheapest silk. And when I brought it back to America and I started working with my aunt on the dress, she's like, this is really hard to work with because it was really polyester. And polyester is a really cheap material and certainly inexpensive. but I, you know, you live, you learn. I learned at that trip that I have to really understand textiles, which I'm so grateful. I went to Parsons and got a higher education and learned about fabrics and construction because as a senior in high school, I had no idea what I was doing, but guess what? That certainly didn't stop me from trying. My senior year, we got to do senior project. Do you guys still have that in Bexley?
We have a capstone option.
Oh, okay. Well, what that meant back then was that you could pursue whatever it is that you wanted to do within a sort of a mentorship situation, whether with a business or on your own. And for me, it was fashion design. So I mentored with a weaver that I'd met through Columbus College of Art and Design. And I wove some textiles and I knit some textiles and they became like little tops. And then we had a little fashion show at Bexley High School. So technically, Bexley High School was my first fashion show ever.
That's awesome.
That's great. And my models were my friends, my fellow classmates, my fellow cheerleaders. And it was a lot of fun. And it felt so rewarding to get to do that and to have a high school that would support that. So that would be the first time I had a real fashion.
Great. Who else wants to ask a question? You can go ahead and unmute yourself if you like.
Hi. My name is Zoe Winger, and I'm a senior at Bexley, and I'm going to Kent State for fashion design next year. And I was just wondering if you have any, like, fashion school tips?
Oh, totally. And Steve, since we're doing Q&A right now, is there a way, I would love to be able to see the person pop up on my screen when they're talking.
Yes, if you go to speaker view, go up to the top right and click on speaker view, when the person, instead of, there's a, at the top right, there's like a option of like, one is like.
Oh, speaker view, okay. Yep. Great.
Whoever's speaking. So actually, will you ask your question again so she can see you?
Yeah, absolutely. I am going to fashion school next year at Kent. And I'm just wondering if you have any fashion school tips.
I do. I think I have to cancel the spotlight video. Okay, cancel the spotlight video.
Now.
I see you, Steve. Now, speaker view.
Who just asked that question?
Zoe Winger. Hello.
Yes, it works. Magic. Thank you, guys. And you know what, again, and I'm sorry, maybe because I have so many interns, I'm really used to talking to people in this way, but look, I'm not embarrassed to point out the fact that I'm not really that great at Zoom. I'm going to bring it up, I'm going to point it out, because by not being embarrassed and by asking the question, I'm going to learn today. And so the next time I do one of these videos, I'm going to know because Steve helped me, Steve answered my question. So a big part of being a designer, artist, or independent human being is not being scared to ask questions, so that's how you learn. So Zoe, it's really nice to meet you. And you're about to be a freshman at Kent State next year?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and what do you know what your major is? Did you say it?
Fashion design.
Fashion design, amazing. So, and you were asking for just general advice?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'll give you some general advice, but I'd love to hear more specific questions about that. It really, general advice is prepare to work really hard it's not academics. It's a lot of physical labor when you're making a collection or drawing. So it takes a lot of time. So even though maybe in high school you did a lot of academics and it took a lot, and you felt like you were working super hard, it's a different kind of work when you're actually physically making the product, because you're limited by time. You're going to have deadlines. Your teacher's going to say, you need to have this dress sewn by Tuesday. And if you're a perfectionist, you're going to be like, there's no way I'm going to physically be able to finish this dress by Tuesday. And you're going to have to learn to really manage your time, manage expectations, and realize that as an artist, nothing is ever done. I believe there's a really famous quote about that. And so sometimes things just have to be good enough. That's a big piece of advice to help you keep your mental sanity as a design student. Don't be scared to experiment. I'm going to give you a bit of hard advice because it's very hard to follow this. But if you can, amazing. Your teachers are just human beings. And some of your teachers are going to be incredible, and some of your teachers are not going to be incredible. They're human beings. Remember why you went to school. Remember what you're trying to accomplish. And if someone is saying no, and they're being constructive about it, listen to them. But if someone is being no and resistant, saying no and being resistant, and you can't really figure out why, just realize they're a person. They're a person, and they're not God, and you don't always have to listen to them. And Steve probably hates me for saying that, but it's something I wish as someone, I'm a people pleaser. I wanted to make all my teachers happy all the time, in high school, in college, and looking back upon my life as an adult, I can say I wish that I had stood up for myself a little bit more instead of just necessarily doing the thing that my teacher wanted me to do. Because they're generally good people, and they usually have a reason why they want to do something, but you also have to remember that they might not know you very well, they might not know your goals, and they might also have their own personal baggage that they're bringing to the situation. I know that's not exactly what you were expecting.
No, I actually love that advice. And I think particularly for young women, I think a lot of times women are taught to like be compliant or to do what people expect of them. And I think to be a strong and independent woman, you have to simply have the courage of your own convictions and be able to stand in a space to say, okay, this is what I think, and this is where I'm going to be. And, you know, it's not always about pleasing.
And, you know, a good teacher will answer your questions. A good teacher won't get defensive. If you ask them, well, why did you tell me to change this? They'll explain it. And a teacher who's maybe not as great will get defensive. And that's a way for you can tell who to listen to and not to listen to.
That's great. Who else would like to ask a question of Natalia?
Me.
Do you have a favorite collection or do you have a favorite piece that you've made?
When you say collection, do you mean my collection or do you mean another designer's?
Yeah, collection.
Okay. I don't know. All my dresses are my babies. We put in a lot of time into each piece that we make in my line is handmade, and there's weeks of time that often go into one dress. So it's very hard to say what is my favorite. I really love the dress that you guys quickly saw in Empire. I'll pull it up at the end of this Q&A. There was this dress that that Cookie, the character on Empire, just wore this like a month ago. And that dress, when I originally made it, it was actually intended for Naomi Grossman to wear to the Emmys. And she ended up picking a different dress. And I was very upset about it. It didn't work out like I thought it would. But I made that dress specifically for Naomi. It didn't work out for Naomi. That dress has been everywhere. That dress got into the World of Wearable Art competition in New Zealand. It's the reason I got to go to New Zealand. That dress got me so many fashion editorials. The truth is that dress is not usually something I would design because it had a pattern to it. And I like really solid colors. And so I like to use that dress as an example of something I love because I didn't realize I was gonna love it. And that's why it's so important to maybe not be your own critic. As designers and artists, we're very harsh on ourselves. I think, maybe I'm wrong. Are you the one that followed me on Instagram today? Is that you?
Yes.
Yeah, so you paint, right?
I paint, yeah.
Yeah, so I actually did click on your profile and I saw that you paint. And you're very good, by the way. You're very, very talented. And I just want you to know that sometimes you're going to paint something and you're not going to love it. You're going to think it's not very good. And maybe it's not very good, but also maybe it's excellent. So remember that, you know, an artist is not necessarily the best judge of their own work because we have so many preconceptions we're bringing to it. So I love that dress. Let me see if I can pull it up. I'm going to screen share for you guys just for a second.
Natalia, while you do this, can you, is there a student asking a question?
I was.
Go ahead.
Where did you start drawing your fashion?
That's a great question. I will answer that in just a second. Let me just play this video to finish up my answer to the other student who just asked a question. So this is this dress I was talking about so you guys can know what I was. I'm gonna have sound. So she's an award-winning actress and she's wearing my dress.
You all can relax while I set up the next shot.
This is very exciting for me.
You look beautiful, Ma.
Thank you. So elegant. It's just doesn't look any
So that's that for that. And
she's not only wearing the dress, but they're talking about how awesome it is as well.
Yeah, exactly. I think there's a moment that happens right after that where another character talks about how pretty the dress is. So that's very exciting for me. And I got that opportunity through a costume designer. But that was the dress that I was referring to. And now back to the student who asked about sketching, right? Drawing.
Yeah.
You said, where do I sketch? Do you mean like what materials do you use, or
do you like sketch in like a book? Because I have like a fashion notebook that I sketch my drawings in.
I sketch everywhere. You know, I'm trying to teach myself to start sketching in an iPad. I have been resistant to it. I still am. I do have an Apple iPad with an Apple Pencil, and I love what my fellow designers are doing with that, but I am still sketching on paper. I like really nice paper. So if you can get a sketchbook that has a good quality paper that doesn't smear too much when you're sketching, are you sketching with pencils or what do you sketch
with? I sketch with pen and pencil.
Okay, great. So pen is pretty good. It doesn't really smear, but sometimes when you have a number two pencil and you rub this part of your hand across it, it'll smear. So you have to make sure that you're getting a kind of paper that has a nice texture to it. So that's something next time you go to an art store, or maybe even call an art store, because I know right now we can't really go to stores. You can ask them about that. You can be like, hey, do you guys recommend any paper for using with pencil? Usually the people who work at art stores are really knowledgeable. But yeah, I love a good sketchbook. It doesn't have to be a fashion sketchbook. But if at your age, what I would recommend is taking a look at some, if you're specifically interested in fashion, there are actually little books you can buy online that will teach you how to do fashion figures. And that's a very specific way of drawing. And it's never too early to learn. And they are kind of coloring book style. I believe they might even have tracing paper in them. So that's something you can look into. And I can certainly guide you more on that if your parents or you have questions about those resources. That would be something that if I was your age, I would have loved to have gotten.
So Natalia, Lily asked a question in the chat about taking the design from a picture to an actual piece. So you draw a picture of something, you have an image of in your head of what it's going to be like. What's the process from getting from there to like actually making that piece of clothing a living thing?
Well, it's so different. And I know, like, sorry, the Kent State student, Zoe, right? It's going to be very different what you do in college than what you do in real life. So as a student, I would draw everything. I came into Parsons, my strongest skill was sketching. I could draw realistically. I had no idea how to sew. I was behind everyone. I was learning how to do it. So I really communicated with drawing. And then I would work really, really hard to make a physical object that looked like my sketch. And some of my teachers were very irritated with me because they'd be like, that's impossible. That fabric doesn't work that way. And I swear to God, I would somehow make it happen. I'm not saying it was the most comfortable thing to wear or the most practical thing to wear, but I was so determined to mimic my sketch. And as a more mature designer, I realized that sometimes you have to really listen to the material and change your design as you're working, because your expectations are not necessarily what's going to happen. And although it's really cool to push things to the max, sometimes in the process of pushing things to the max, you sort of lose the functionality of the object. So I sketched a lot. When I was a younger designer, I sketched a lot and then worked really hard. As someone who has their own company, I don't actually do a lot of fashion sketching anymore. And the reason for that is because a lot of what I do is either knitting or jewelry making, or the metal clothing. Like the scarf I'm wearing is metal, actually. And that's very textile oriented and it's very technical. There's a lot of math. So all you fashion students, I hated math. You gotta do a lot of math. I still do algebra. I'm one of those examples of human beings who actually does high school math on a daily basis. So I'm not so much using trigonometry or calculus anymore, but I gotta tell you, algebra is my friend. And you still need trigonometry in fashion because you got curves. So to answer your question, nowadays we do technical sketches where if you know anything about knitting, you have to really figure out how many stitches are in an inch and you do a kind of boring little drawing, but it's, you do the fancy pretty illustrations when you're using those to share with social media or share with a client. But for internal in company, you do kind of boring little drawings. Sorry, you have a question?
Wait, did anyone else say anything?
No, go ahead.
So I forgot what I was going to say. Sorry.
That's okay. Natalia, Zoe asked a question about getting in touch with some of those celebrities, and it sounds like you had the right contact who could get you in touch with some of them, and then your network grew from there. What's your experience been like of the celebrity culture? I mean, we all kind of like follow people on Instagram and watch people.
I would love to talk about that, because I think growing up, and I think Zoe and other fashion oriented people, it's so exciting, the idea of something you design being worn by someone famous, right? Like, it's just so exciting because you see them on TV and they're icons and they're so amazing, and something you touch touches them. So I'm going to have two thoughts on that. One, they're just people. They're just people like you and I who happen to be very successful in acting or singing, and it's a very publicly facing career that they have. So don't get too starstruck, one. Two, there are a million different ways to dress a celebrity. I gave you one example. I will give you a few more that I have done myself. You can literally direct message a stylist nowadays. We are living in the internet era. Things are so much easier now than they used to be. What I mean by direct message, I'll give you some tips. First of all, you better have some really good designs now. If you're a seventh grader and you have an amazing, like, you know, prodigy level of fashion design, go ahead, reach out. But the odds are they're probably not going to take you too seriously because you're technically a child. Now, Zoe, maybe you're 17 or 18, you're about to go to school. You actually have a shot. They probably will take you seriously. So you would send them a sketch, or more likely send them a finished design. If you can send them something really professional, like on a model, even better. And you would tell them what it's made out of. And you would say, hey, I would love to send you this dress to try on this celebrity that I see that you style. It would mean a lot to me. Please let me know where to ship it. Two things. Usually they return the shipment. You can't guarantee that they will. And if you want to more likely guarantee that they'll return your design, include a return label. So print a shipping label that they can just quickly stick on it. A lot of stylists are really ethical. I'm happy to guide you on the stylists that I think are really great people. Some stylists are not that ethical. It's like any other industry. Some people will just keep your design and you won't get it back. And that can be extremely heartbreaking when you worked very hard on it and put all of your soul into it. So that's one way that anybody can reach out to a celebrity. You can use your existing contacts. Maybe someone's mom that you know works at Abercrombie & Fitch, and they had this supermodel do their catalog this past year, and you'd love to dress that supermodel. Maybe you can reach out to that person's mom and say, do you know this person? Do you have their contact information? And then you just have to be a hustler and you email them. And you can go online and look up their manager information, their publicist information. So this is sort of a bit more of a high level response. I realize that for a lot of you, it's not relevant, but maybe Zoe, as you continue as a design student, don't be scared to be ballsy. Don't be scared to be annoying. I always say better to be annoying than to not get what you want. And the truth is, if you're polite while you're annoying, most people will forgive you. I hope that answers that.
How do you make metal into clothes?
Well, that is quite a complicated situation. You remember seeing pictures of like the Knights of the Round Table or King Arthur and things like this?
Nope.
Okay, when you think of like a knight with a sword on a horse, like mm-hmm. the Middle Ages, did you guys study Middle Ages yet?
Nope.
Okay. Well, this thing called chainmail. And chainmail is something that knights used to wear back in the day in order to protect their bodies from the piercing of a sword. You know, back then they didn't really have bullets, but they had swords. And chainmail is two rings that interlock like this. Mm-hmm. And you can close them using pliers. And if you get enough of those rings together, you can actually make a piece of material. So metal clothing has existed for a very long time. What I do is a little different. I take chain that already exists and I weave it in order to create a textile. And that's what gives it this amazing stretch. Now, it's patent pending, which means I'm currently working with the US government to secure a patent because I'm the first person to commercially do this. It's a whole other process, but guess what? There's a million different ways to make metal into a textile. And maybe you're gonna invent another really cool textile. So don't be afraid to experiment. Go online, look up different techniques. Maybe learn about chainmail. At your age, you can certainly do chainmail. So if you're taking notes, write down the word chainmail, look up how to do chainmail. You can buy a kit on Amazon today. They'll mail it to you. And you can even just make yourself a little necklace to begin with, or a bracelet. I highly encourage you to try it out.
I have a question.
Uh-huh. Hi, Michelle.
Oh, my name's Rachel. That's my mom's name. But who did you look up to as a child, and did you ever get to meet any of them?
Wow. Well, I'll give you one. Maryland Avenue Elementary School celebrity. So there was this writer named R.L. Stine mm-hmm. who went to Maryland Avenue Elementary School, and I, hold on a second, I have to show you this. Because, where is it? Is it up here? I have a bookshelf right next to where I'm sitting. Oh no, is it not here? I was going to show you something really exciting. Oh, here's one of the books. I don't think this was signed. So, still have his books. because I'm in Columbus, Ohio right now. I'm not in New York at the moment. And so I grew up reading these books, which are all signed books. And I didn't even know he went to Maryland Elementary School when I started reading his books. I just loved scary books. I loved horror and mystery and science fiction. And he went to Maryland Elementary School. And I remember in fifth grade, he did a book signing. And I was so excited. And he was probably the first celebrity I met. And it was 2 seconds. He signed my books and that was it. But it was still really cool to know that this guy had gone to my school and that he was writing things that I really enjoyed reading. And I've been a lifelong fan of his. So that was probably one of the first celebrities I've met. Of the more famous people I've met, like I said, I've met Naomi because she was my website design client before that. But did I meet Jennifer Lopez or Beyonce? No, I didn't. I know that it's probably sad for you guys to hear that. But as a designer, I'm not necessarily working immediately with the celebrities. There are these people called stylists whose job it is to put clothing on the celebrities. And the stylists are kind of like the gatekeepers. And those stylists decide who and what to try on the celebrities. And then they have tailors who alter the clothing, or they have tailors who pin the clothing and send it back to me so I can alter it, because metal is kind of hard to alter. But I very rarely get to meet that level of celebrity. Now, I have met Lenny Kravitz many, many times. He's very charming and very nice. And that's because I work with a store in Los Angeles that his stylist actually owns. So his stylist and I have a really good relationship. They sell my clothing and he costume designs for Lenny. And so I've had the honor of touching those abs. but yeah, it depends. It just depends. But yeah, and he's probably my favorite celebrity that I've met if I had to pick one.
I had one question.
Yes.
Since I'm Indian, I tend to sketch a lot of like traditional Indian clothing. So I was wondering, have you ever sketched or designed like traditional Ukrainian clothing or?
You know, it's a little, yes and no. I've actually have designed a collection based on Indian clothing when I was at Parsons because I loved Indian culture. I've been to India several times. Have you been to India? Have you been to India yet?
Yeah, 2 times.
Great, me too.
Yeah, I have.
I've been to India twice. So I loved Indian culture. So I've actually designed a collection based on Indian culture. But Ukrainian culture, it's a little complicated, but it's not really my culture. It's the country I'm from, but it's not really my culture. I am very inspired by different cultures' embroidery and beading techniques. When I was in Paris, I studied haute couture, and haute couture is a lot of detail work. So I highly encourage you to not just think of your culture generally, but really dig in to the very different techniques that exist. I mean, Indian culture is so rich. You're so lucky to have that be your culture. There's so much there. And they have some incredible textiles and incredible, I mean, they are, just so you know, the majority of the fashion houses in the world get their embroideries from India. I mean, whether it's French designers or American designers, when you see incredibly beautifully beaded clothing, that's coming from India. So there's a really rich history there.
Thank you.
Somebody else have a question at hand?
And I have Steve's questions that Steve, you sent over to me earlier. I'm going to pull up.
Yeah. Natalia, what's in your future? Like when you look forward, I mean, are you looking 5 or 10 years down the road, or is it like the next project, things keep coming up and you're kind of reacting?
I think when I was your age, when I was in middle school and high school, I was very future focused. I looked so much towards, I was like, I knew exactly what I want to do. I was one of those lucky students in high school who was just tunnel vision, that I'm going to be a famous fashion designer. But the truth is, as an adult, I very rarely have that clarity anymore. And that's because life is complicated. So I don't plan as far ahead as I used to. I try really hard to focus on a couple of small things and work on them, because as an artist, for me personally, it can be very overwhelming to focus too far down the line. A good example of that is in December, I was connected to a woman who said she could sell my clothing in Paris. As a designer, this is very exciting. Of course I want this. And we were supposed to meet in early January, and then my grandmother passed away actually. So I was in Los Angeles and I flew back to Ohio, which is where my grandma lived, for the funeral. And by the time I got back to LA, that woman was no longer able to meet. And so that opportunity disappeared. And at that time, I was like, I know I had to go to my grandma's funeral. I love my grandma, I don't regret it. But it was upsetting that something I had been working on for years, the desire to sell in Paris, might have disappeared just because the opportunity wasn't coming at the right time. And then guess what, guys? Right now we are living in a time period where all brick and mortar stores are pretty much closed across the world. retail is really suffering. Stores that put in orders are canceling orders. So I might have had French stores that had put in orders in February and March based on this relationship that I had produced with this woman that would now be getting canceled and that I would be losing money because I would have made the effort to produce that stuff and now I wouldn't have someone buying it because they would have canceled those contracts. I know I'm using some kind of big words, but what I'm trying to say is when something really bad happens, sometimes it happens for a reason, or sometimes there's something good that can come from the bad thing and it takes months or years to look back and realize, you know what, there is a silver lining. And I realized that the other day when I was thinking about this past year. And I want you all to apply that to your life when an opportunity that you were excited about disappeared, or you didn't win something, or you didn't get first place. Things happen for a reason.
And I think you make an interesting point, Natalia, because on one hand, it's really powerful to have a clear vision and to pursue it like doggedly for a long term. But also sometimes it's good to be fluid and be able to like adjust as new things come up and be able to be, you know, like I was really into that, but now some new opportunity came up and I want to pursue that. So there's some balance between having a long-term vision and also being flexible so you can
change. That's everything, Steve. That's everything. The whole lecture I did with Parsons, New School University, which maybe Zoe as a student who's about to go to Kent State knows about Parsons, was about adaptability. I was like, I can talk on a number of topics. And I'm like, no, Natalia, we want you to talk about adaptability because you're a unique person through immigration and 9/11 and all these other events in your life, you've been forced to adapt. And I can tell you guys, it doesn't matter if you're in sixth grade or you're 37 years old, adapting is everything. And a part of that is perspective. How do you feel about what's happening? You get to choose every single day whether you react positively and negatively. And it's completely okay to feel sad and upset, but you can choose to stop feeling sad. So that's what I would emphasize. Adapting is realizing that you have more control than you're giving yourself and taking that control and giving yourself permission to fail as well. Because in order to adapt, you have to try a couple different things before you find the thing that works. I mean, Steve, I was an actor for a minute and I certainly didn't think I was going to become a professional actor when I was graduating from high school. But I'm so grateful that I did that because it was super fun.
Yeah, and I'm going to use that comment to make a quick commercial for tomorrow. We have a session on growth mindset, and what you're describing is kind of a growth mindset. It's like whatever things happen, how do I frame it in a way that's going to give me an opportunity to grow? Yeah. So if any of you are interested in what Natalia is talking about today, check out our session tomorrow on growth mindset. We have time for maybe one more question. Is anybody else?
I have a couple of private questions. Are you able to see those on your end as well, or are they only coming to me?
Those are just coming to you.
How long did it take to get in touch with some of the celebrities from Zoe? Zoe, it depends on the celebrity. There are some celebrities, I still want to dress Madonna. You know, and I've had so many chances where I've come this close. I constantly am bugging her stylist. I've had opportunities where her stylists have borrowed clothing, which is called a style pull, and then it didn't work out. And I really want to emphasize this because when I first started my line, at 30, you'd think I'd be so smart by the time I was 30. No, I still didn't understand how it worked. And when Jennifer Lopez and Beyonce pulled a couple of my pieces right off the bat, I was like, yes, I've made it. And then they didn't wear anything. And I was like, wait, what happened? Did they hate it? And then you start to realize that in the industry, stylists borrow a lot of different things from a lot of different designers, and they don't necessarily even get the chance to try them on celebrity. It really depends on the circumstances. These people are incredibly busy with a lot of events in their life. And so I learned, instead of getting upset at myself and going, oh, I'm a failure, those celebrities didn't wear it, I guess it's not good, I learned, okay, let's give it a few more tries. And I think Jennifer Lopez borrowed things 4 times before she finally wore one of the pieces. So that's to say, like, try and try and try again. And Zoe, so with Jennifer Lopez, it took about, you know, I think 7 or 8 months. And with Madonna, it's been 6 years and I'm still trying.
Well, Natalia, I really want to thank you so much for doing this. It's been really so interesting learning with you. And like, we are so proud of you as one of us out there doing amazing things in the world. Yesterday or 2 days ago, we had a session with on careers in business. And you think like, oh, business is so different from fashion. Business is like this. But so many of the things you said really resonated. And I want to just take a minute. I'm the coordinator of experiential learning. So call this a commercial if you like, but you talked about having like 8 or 9 different internships and how important that was. And I think, you know, the person in the career and business said, when we hire somebody, we use the 70-20-10 rule. 70%, we look at their experiences. 20%, we look at their network and their relationships. And 10%, we look at their academic record. And I thought that was really interesting because a lot of what you said has been, doing the internships, doing the, you know, the travel, the international experiences. And then you talked a lot about networks, connecting with people, making relationships, being friendly, finding the way to those things. But you didn't talk a lot about your GPA in college or which courses you took in college, although I'm sure those things were very important. I think it's really, you really taught us and reminded us that having experiences, doing internships, getting yourself out in the world is an important way that we learn.
No one has ever asked me when I graduated from college what my GPA was. Not once. No one ever asked. And guess what? It was a really good GPA. But no one ever asked. And I can tell you that people are going to care a lot more about what you can do for the company than what you did in your academics. That is not to say that you should stop taking your tests and fail out of high school. That is simply to say that we all have different talents and skill sets, and some of us are better at English than math and vice versa, and don't kill yourself over it.
So listen, I want to do one thing before we close. So I appreciate you've all asked some great questions, and I want to give Natalia just a little bit of appreciation for coming by. So I want to give you all a chance to say something that you've appreciated, that you've learned, that you've been excited about, or something you admire about her. And you can do it one of two ways. Either you can unmute yourself and say it directly to her, or if you want to, you can type it into the chat bar. And so I just want to take these last couple minutes for you all to give Natalia some appreciation and some props for what you've gotten out of the conversation. So if you want to type something, go ahead and type it. If you want to unmute yourself and say something directly to her, you can do that now.
Well, I really like your clothing. It's really, really pretty.
Thank you so much. And if you guys haven't all gone, I do encourage you to go to my Instagram and my website, because we could only show so much during this talk. And if you have questions later about anything you see, you can email me. You can email me. I don't know, Steve, if there's a specific way they have to reach out to me, because I'm an adult.
You can type your email into the
I'm going to type my email into the chat box right now. Let me go to everyone. So if you guys see something and you have questions, please ask me. But I will say this much. I can't connect you to a stylist. I can't do that for you right now. Now, maybe when you have more experience or you have a portfolio of work, we can talk about that in the future. But right now, just know I can't help you with connecting you to a celebrity or a stylist.
Who else wants to say something to Natalia?
I would like to say something. I think it's really cool that you're from another country and that you came here when you were really little, and then you made it really, you made it big with like celebrities and like with your own brand. So I just think that's really cool.
That's awesome.
Thank you.
Thanks, man. Thank you.
Helma, are you a staff member or a teacher? I see Helma Groot at the bottom right corner.
Yes, I'm a teacher. Zoe is one of my students and I'm really proud of her. I'm one of the two art teachers. Ponce is, I think you had Ponce as a teacher when you were in high school, but I started much later, so.
Is Ponce still there?
Yes, she is.
I still remember when Ponce told our class, I think she was like maybe 32 or 33, she was very young when she was teaching us, that she still had student loans. And I thought to myself, you still have student loans at 32? I didn't finish paying off my student loans till 35. So now I understand how normal that is.
So Rachel, who's also one of our art teachers, really appreciated how inspiring and encouraging you were to young people, and particularly the lessons you taught about how hard work pays off and that failure is an opportunity to learn, and especially to be nice, that you never know who you're going to meet, who can, you know, be a friend or potentially someone that you work with along the way.
And I do think there's some stereotypes about lazy artists and things like this. I'm going to tell you, if you're going to choose any sort of artistic career, writing, acting, drawing, fashion, you're going to have to work 2 to 3 times as hard, maybe even more than people with a regular career, because there's going to be so much in your way, so much adversity, and there's just so much more competition. So you should be prepared to actually work harder than your classmates.
Anybody else want to offer appreciation or something that you're going to walk away from today thinking or remembering?
I am so proud of you, and I appreciate all the words you said to me. Thank you very much. You made my day, and I hope you go on to much, much more success.
Miss Young, where are you right now? Are you in Michigan? I'm trying to remember.
Yes, I live in northern Michigan, where it's 50 degrees and not a leaf on the trees yet. But I love it up here and it's great. But
I still, I have to tell you, I remember so much from that time period. I remember the Georgia O'Keeffe posters on the walls. I think when we're young, things really impact us. So teachers have a real opportunity there, because I certainly don't remember what posters were on the wall at the space I was in last week, but I will never forget those beautiful
walls. Thank you so much. And you don't know those things until you hear them from your students years and years later. And it's great. Thank you.
Thank you.
And another, we have a younger Zoe, in addition to our about to graduate Zoe, who really appreciated you talking about failure and normalizing failure, and that trying something and failing is actually a way we learn, as opposed to like something's wrong or something, we did something bad. That's a really important lesson I think you taught today.
If any of you guys are thinking about starting your own business, and even if it's just selling bracelets or something small, I would encourage Steve. I think this book is palatable enough for a middle schooler. It's called The 4-Hour Work Week by Tim Ferriss. It's a book I read, and it really makes it a lot easier to start a business. It just explains it in very simple terms. Zoe, who's going to college, I would actually recommend you read it now. I read it when I was probably 29, and I think the earlier you read it, the better, because it sort of demystifies things and makes you feel like you can just try things and fail, and it's okay. And it's really great to hear that from an expert.
And that's The 4-Hour Work Week?
The 4-Hour Work Week. It's a lie. You're not going to work 4 hours. You're going to work a million hours. But it's going to give you some really great tips on how to, especially if you start a product-based business, which all fashion products are products. So it teaches you some simple ways to use eBay to test the market, and just really affordable ways. I think a lot of people, when they think about starting a company as they get older, they want to put a bunch of money in it. And that's not very smart, because you could lose that money. And even if you're in seventh grade and you want to create friendship bracelets or whatever, this could be a really great way for you to learn a little bit of entrepreneurial skills at a young age. You can put things on Etsy in seventh grade.
Absolutely. Well, Natalia, thank you so much. It was really just a pleasure to spend an hour with you. Students, thank you for your great questions and for your enthusiasm. You know, Natalia's website is a great place to go and see a lot of her work. And you're making Bexley proud, Natalia. Keep doing your great work. Thank you. Yay.
Thank you. And it's been so fun to meet you guys. I hope that one day I'll be able to do this in person and see you guys. I'm not in Columbus that often, but my parents still do live in Bexley. So when I do come home a couple times a year.